Excellent. Thanks very much indeed. Welcome, everybody. And what a pleasure it is to see all of you here. On such a lovely evening. Fantastic stuff. BTRM, hey? Who would have thought? Welcome to our second Certificate of BTRM Faculty Forum. And Faculty Forum to talk about bank risk management. That's a very large, all-encompassing field. So we only have about an hour or so to do it. And that's just long enough because wouldn't want to spend too much longer with the evening being as pleasant as it is. I would like to take this opportunity, before we kick off, first to thank very much, from the bottom of my heart, Harmless Robertson and indeed Mr. Vijay Krishnaswamy for these facilities, which are very welcome and much appreciated. So, and they do lay on a very good spread, don't they? Mm-hmm. See, he had never asked me, but I'm a big fan of R. White's lemonade. So, that's a fantastic spread. I'm chuffed, you know. I was going to nick a bottle, actually, on the way home. So thank you very much, Timers. Really appreciate that. And they've looked after us really well. Also want to thank, of course, right from the start, again, the panel, all faculty members of the BTRM, esteemed in their own way. Let's introduce them. And what a panel we have to talk about tonight's subject, which, by the way, is a bit long-winded, isn't it? Proactive ALM, asset liability management. How to ensure balance sheet optimization in an environment of regulation and tough competition. Now, that is not, you know, a journal article title, is it? You know, the sub-editor would cut that the subtitle straight away. But it's quite an interesting field. There's all kinds of things we have to be concerning ourselves with at the moment, whether we are in small banks or large banks, foreign banks or UK banks, and so on and so forth. So let's see if we can cover some of those topics to some value-added depth this evening. And as I said, what a panel I have to discuss it with me. From the top, I have Patricia Garrity, who is Director of Treasury Audit at TSB, a close personal friend of mine and member of my team in our previous job. Next to her is Chris Westcott, also all faculty members, of course. Chris Westcott, who is faculty BTRM. He has some other irons in the fire, which I'm sure he'll tell you about when you get to chat to him afterwards. Close personal friend of mine and a former colleague, you detect a pattern here, former colleague of mine in a previous job. Next to him is Enrique Benito, who is with Deloitte Consulting on the banking side. Close personal friend of mine, not a former colleague though, so a bit of a buck in the trend there. Also on the faculty of BTRM, and of course, last but not least, Mr. Chris Edwards, who you remember, along with Chris Westcott, was on the first forum. He's treasurer of FBN Bank here in London, and a close personal friend of mine. So, welcome to them. Let's see whether by the end of it they will be worthy each of a bottle of that 5 litres of Romanian Riesling that I've got squirreled away somewhere. That's from Only Fools and Horses. I wondered who you'd get that. Or whether they'll be entitled to that that mineral water bottled in the mountains of Afghanistan. No, you don't get that one? That's from Max and Paddy's Road to Nowhere. Right, we're running out of quotes here. So let's see which ones they're worthy of. Or it's a bottle of cheap plonk. Let's see. I want to kick off as well. Before I do, one more thing. This forum is also for the first time, the first of our forums, in association with FinRisk, the Financial Risk Institute. And I'm sure one or two of them are joining us online. I'd like to welcome those who are online. this is the thing about the BTRM. It's a global project. One doesn't have to be in London to benefit from its value add, he says modestly. And so welcome to those online, one or two of which will be coming from FinRisk, the Financial Risk Institute in Washington, who are accrediting the BTRM as well. So welcome to them. Thank you. So let's kick off then. Tonight's subject, proactive ALM. So whether you work in finance, risk or treasury in a bank or non-bank financial institution, I'm sure the topic will be of interest to you. And the first one to kick off with, so it's an open-ended one to an extent. What is each panelist's priority action list, right? What's their priority action list? If they were, for example, an ALCO member in charge of balance sheet risk at a bank, what would be their priority action list to ensure compliance from a regulatory perspective? So, of course, we go into CRD4 territory from BIPRU in October. What's their priority action list that they'd want to see being done at a hypothetical institution of their choice? And also how one should go about optimising the balance sheet from an asset liability perspective to ensure this compliance and also maintain competitive edge. So, sounds a complicated question, but actually it's simpler than it sounds. Mr. Westcott, do you want to kick off with that one, please?
It's funny the way we move along the line.
It's pretty simple.
Okay. So, it won't surprise you to hear that we did at least get some idea of the questions that Moorad was going to ask beforehand, at least some idea. But as I thought about this, kind of my brain went in the direction of, well, that there's some regulation that's here already that we probably don't do very well. There's some that's coming, and there's some that's future. And as a ALCO member or treasurer, I think I'd be mindful of all of those. So, I mean, the lists, as we'll find, can probably go on forever. So I'll just pick out a few from each area. In terms of, should we say, what's coming, to my mind, the ICB changes, few years out, from my experience, the organisations I've worked with seem to be generally slower off the mark than quicker off the mark for something that, as you move around structures and assets, liabilities from entity to entity, I can see those as being pretty significant changes and needing very long lead times. So that would be one on my horizon today. In terms of, should we say, rules that are already in that we probably don't do very well, couple of thoughts here. So I'm personally not really very happy with, from a data perspective. I haven't yet to see a bank that I think really deals with data effectively. So when you've got things like liquidity coverage ratio, and you think, well, I'd like to go in and prod that and see how good are banks and my hypothetical institution if I've got a report on my movements every day. And my challenge would be, I don't think banks are that good. And I'd expect my hypothetical institution not to be that good. And in a similar vein, we're all getting much more involved in stress testing. And the basis for a lot of the stress testing is the base data. And again, I think that it's likely in most instances it's not as good as it should be. In terms of just sticking on a Basel theme, it lasts for a very long time, and we should we say, be mindful of the fact that some of the Basel regulations aren't fully in yet. So things like the leverage ratio, I mean, we are reporting on that at group level, but in the little words, basically all banking entities need to satisfy it from 2018, and I think that needs some very careful viewing at subsidiary level, because I think everybody's just, should we say, looked at the top, looked at the group says 4.5, fine, tick the box and moved on, whereas as you delve into the rules, there's every chance that your subsidiaries might find life difficult, and then that might require some pretty significant changes. So I'd be worried about that as well. And then I don't want to kind of come up with all the answers, but a couple of things that are,
yes,
should we say,
I dread who's going to come last on this panel.
Yeah. Well, you pick me, you ask me to go.
No, please carry on, absolutely.
I would say a couple of areas that basically change is coming, and to position my institution as well as it could be positioned, I'd like to be at the forefront of that change. So things like interest rate risk in the banking book, the rules, people first set out best practice in the early 2000s, but it's never really stuck. And I think as we move forward, that will be more significant. And then I can see there's a, should we say, another go at the securitisation rules and all the RWAs, etc., associated with them. That would be one that I would want to stay close to, especially as securitisation as a market has, I say, started to come back. And I think once you strip away all the squares and cubes and all of that stuff, actually you've got a really robust product there. And I would expect that market to come back. And to that extent, it's something that it would be a tool that my function would use, either from a liquid asset perspective or origination perspective, and therefore I would want to be at the forefront of those changes.
OK,
Excellent.
That's
thank
only half
much.
The ones on my list, but that's my priority.
I want to make sure we come back to the other half. That's fantastic. That's great. We're going to touch on every one of those topics in due course, actually. I especially like the bit at the end about once you get rid of the squares and the cubes. I remember JP Morgan working on a CDO cubed. What a load of nonsense that was. Right, thank you very much. Patricia, I see you're champing at the bit there. Please, let's have your priority action list for your hypothetical bank.
Coming at things just from a slightly different angle, but all connected, of course, I guess pricing the risk for me would be a big issue. I think the transparency, the ability to incentivize the appropriate behavior, I think those would be key issues. I think good behavioral modeling, so that you understand the structure of your balance sheet, not just on a contractual basis, but really on a behavioural basis, and that you're going back to interest rate risk, you're managing your interest risk actively. Those would be huge issues. And I think they still lead through to regulation, because the regulators are very keen, particularly in the wake of the credit crunch, to know that banks are pricing their risk, and that, you know, say, for example, Treasury at the centre is pushing the appropriate pricing through out to the business and ultimately to the customer. So that risks are managed from on an end-to-end basis. So I guess those would be my particular points.
Thank you very much, and we will come back to those as well. Mr. Edwards.
Yeah, I think coming from a smaller bank, and the major concern I have as a head of Treasury really is and guiding ALCO to ensure that the bank's safe and sound. And I think You can't emphasise enough how important it is for a small bank to maintain adequate liquidity and cash. And I think a lot of people make a mistake where they're looking for great returns on capital, maximise every possible cent they can get their hands on, but they forget that you can put a bank at risk very easily like that. And in a small bank, it's either feast or famine. Everything goes wrong at the same time. You can guarantee that's going to happen. So, you have to build in really robust buffers, and not only the liquidity asset buffer, and there you are sitting there with a nice lot of high quality liquid assets, which we've seen over the last 2.5 days. If you happen to be down the yield curve, which some of the younger practitioners in the market might think, well, they're under a lot of pressure to maximise gain, decide the 10 years a better bet because rates are going to remain stable, blah, blah, blah. And, they've had a shock over the last 2 days. And, I still have a really big sort of bugbear with the regulators that, the only really liquid asset is cash. And Moorad sings from the same hymn sheet. I think that his feeling and mine is that they should have had a requirement in cash. I think there should be weightings on how far you can go out maturities. Too many people are trying to make a profit from a liquid asset buffer, and to me, safe and sound.
Thank you very much. No, excellent. That was on agenda, but you know what? I think it's important. It should be talked about. Very interesting observation. So this is right up to the minute. We've just seen the price action in sovereign bond markets the last 2-3 weeks, which I was, as a neutral observer, I never get riskier than holding UK T-bills myself. But as a neutral observer, I quite like the fact that we've pulled back from anything approaching negative interest rates. So there was that Swiss 10-year bond issue, the govies, a couple of months ago that was negative, which, if that persists, if it went into the Bund territory, so we had 10-year bunds at negative rates, finance turns on its head, you can't price, it just becomes a nonsense. So that's good.
They got to point of
yield. Absolutely, I know, it got to single-digit yields, I know. But this is a very important point. I mean, you said some of the younger practitioners, I want to extract yield out of the LAB, the liquid asset buffer, so I might hold, and I'm aware of some smaller banks that are holding 30-year gilts. So how have they lost out on mark-to-market in the last couple of weeks? The liquid asset buffer, if you're trying to extract yield, and this is a conversation I remember having with a finance director that Patricia knows as well as I do, if you're trying to extract yield out of the liquid asset buffer to make your budget target for 2-3 years from now, you've got slightly the wrong business model, because it's just there to mitigate risk. But separate topic, we will come to that. Thank you very much for that. And it is an up-to-the-minute thing, what's happening in bond markets at the moment. I mean, personally, I think investors are seeing sense. Why would I lend money to the German government for 10 years at 7 basis points, let alone the Swiss government for a negative yield? It's a nonsense, isn't it? So I think the market's seeing sense, but obviously in the meantime, some people are getting burned if they're holding that paper. Right, thank you very much. And last but always not least, Mr. Enrique, sir, what's your priority action list from the observer point of view? Or just imagine you have a hypothetical bank behind you at Deloitte's.
Sure.
Which may well happen, right? Non-bank competitors, you know, fintech and all that.
Well, as an ex-regulator, I'd say that...
Always a handy opinion.
That my first priority will actually not be regulation. My first priority will be understanding the risks you drive in your business and understanding the impact of those risks in your business. And this may sound trivial, but it's not. And when I speak to executives in the marketplace, I usually tend to encounter two types of people. Those that are very focused on the business, on the management, and those that are very focused on the regulation. I want to comply with regulation and ensure I'm fine, and the PRA or FCA or whoever is not going to come and hit me. I think what regulators want and what the business wants is really to do a thorough assessment of the risk. And when I say risk, it's not just prudential risk, but it covers also conduct risks and interdependencies between different types of risks. And then see where you are, see how can you create a culture from the top that deals with those risks. And then I can deal with regulation in a second point, right? A second derivative, if you like. And that obviously, when you go to regulation and the regulatory space, that covers capital, covers liquidity, covers leverage, it covers interest in the banking book, trading book, securitization. So the whole framework being very complex. And the reason why it's so difficult to manage is because you can't defend what are your risks, right? And what's driving your business. So in that sense, I mean, panelists have said very interesting things. Pricing is very important, pricing risk. Doing proper stress testing. I mean, I always put example, I mean, if we were in a business where we do parachuting, right? Nobody will get surprised. The half staff is actually looking at the parachutes and ensuring that they work properly. When we work in banking, everybody gets surprised that half the staff needs to work on risk management, right? So I just want to use an example and think about the implications. I mean, this is a risky business that needs to be driven proactively and not reactively. We have an outcourse, ex-course, they have to think, what are my risks of running this business, and how can I mitigate those risks? So I will say that's my takeaway. I mean, we can get into whether cash is liquid or not liquid. I mean, it's true in Chris, obviously cash is supposed to be the liquid heart of the company. When you get into the really nitty-gritty, you start thinking, well, is cash really liquid? Well, like it or not, in the US, based on the LCR rules, cash is not liquid. In the UK at the moment, cash is not liquid. But under the LCR rules in Europe now, cash is liquid. And I've been discussing this, and I got someone that asked me, oh, hang on, but I got some cash in my ATMs. Is this really liquid? Because overnight I got a sweep from some correspondent bank that's taking it over. So we can lead into all these details. That
let's do that now. Okay. So I've noted your points. So I'm going to come back to them. Was there anything else, Enrique?
I think that
was okay. That's more than enough.
I don't want. Yeah.
let me just address that now quickly because it's pertinent. If I on my second guess, Mr. Edwards, so correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think when we were both saying it was the most liquid asset, I certainly meant at the central bank. I don't mean it's on its way in from another bank or it's an asset I've got, but it's somehow, you know, in physical form, you know, in a delivery van. I meant at the central bank and I can access it
as a buffer,
as an instance. Yeah, that's what I meant. I must admit, if there are operational issues, right, exactly, as you said, if there are operational issues and the cash is expected to come in or it's from yesterday's overnight close, but it's coming from a correspondent bank this morning and there's a crash, you know, what's the next one? What's the equivalent of Lehman going bust today? I don't know, there's war in Ukraine or something, I don't know. Or better still, we have negative rates for 10 years. I can't assume that will come in from anywhere else. I just meant what I can instantly access. And think about it, intraday liquidity risk, you could only mitigate with cash, can't you? Because it's intraday. What can I turn into cash today? I mean, I have to be able to, it's like you and I, we can only get something out of an ATM machine today, right? If it's in any other form, we need to wait a day or two or three. That's what I meant. So I take your point, and it's a very valid one, that operationally, if the cash isn't in the genuine cash at the central bank form for instant access, I agree, it's not necessarily as liquid as a T-bill. It could be the same liquidity.
That's interesting because actually we just ran a survey across banks on their liquidity coverage ratio. And it's interesting to see that basically 50% of respondents said, I consider central banks as a key characteristic for an asset to be liquid. 50% said, I don't consider central banks.
Because they'll take any old rubbish.
So, see, regulators are saying, no, sorry, I mean, central banking access, although we all think is a key for liquidity, you can't consider that. Because you're taking, it's like driving on your highway and saying, oh, because I have insurance, I can crash. That's fine.
No, I don't agree with that analogy. We're going to come back to this because we're going to get bogged down in this. If I go give cash at the central bank and I can draw it instantly, I don't see how that can't be liquid. But I don't mean any other asset. If an RMBS is eligible as collateral at the central bank, placing an RMBS at the central bank isn't as liquid as placing cash. So I'm not talking about the eligibility of the asset. I'm talking about actually giving them cash. So I take a £5 note out of my wallet, I give it to the Bank of England and say, can you hold that for me? I can take that back at any time. It's a £5 note.
Central bank reserves.
Above the minimum reserve. I think we can agree on that. I take your operational risk more than the other one.
The minimum will be encumbered, effectively.
Yes, absolutely. Because the minimum... Yes, that's a very good point, actually. It's got to be above the minimum.
There isn't a minimum.
Yes. Well, yeah, whatever they say you'd have to have as cash. It's got to be above any specified minimum because... And by the way, any other opinion, I'm always happy to hear. It's got to be above the specified minimum because the minute you drop a pound below the minimum, you're out of business anyway, right? So it's got to be the bit that's above that that's unencumbered. I think that's ultimately the liquid asset. And I think that's what you were talking about as well, Chris. Yeah, okay. Right. Let's just keep that at the back of our heads. Thank you very much. Right. We've got lots there, okay? Now, this is... we're all friends here. So we don't wait till the end. That was the first question. So we've got our priority action lists from each of the panelists. All very valid, okay?
More
at least bank, yes, sir.
Just one point linking to what Enrique was saying around the how do you optimise your origination process?
Which was the next question.
Are you just about to ask that?
Yes.
Carry on and
No, I'm going to... Go ahead.
So you asked it at the beginning.
I probably would have gone to you first anyway.
Oh, right. You asked it at the beginning, yes. and then you covered the first bit. But anyway, so this optimisation of the process... one thing that certainly in a former organisation I worked with that we looked at and it never quite came reality is if we say how many regulatory initiatives are there, we could probably come up with 100. And then certainly my experience is if we've got a regulatory initiative on whatever, let's say liquidity coverage ratio, we form a team that does liquidity coverage ratio. And that team works out how to report it. And if you're lucky, that team does it across all the relevant parts of the bank. If you're unlucky, there's 15 teams doing liquidity coverage ratio all in different parts of the bank. Okay, that's just what happens.
Yes.
Now,
very true.
A different way of looking at regulation, which is a little bit closer to where you're coming from, is say, right, let's go up about four levels and look at each of those regulations and kind of then push the whole lot together because there's a huge amount of crossover. What you need to satisfy one type of regulation is actually quite similar to what you need elsewhere often. And if you're looking at, I don't know, gap analysis for liquidity, you know, should we say liquidity coverage ratios, that's not that different to some of the elements you might need to analyse interest rate risk, though. But it's kind of, you know, it's a subtly different thing. So where I'm coming from is that you try, rather than look at them all individually, you try and go up and look at them collectively and work out what it is you need to do to manage each of the kind of the top level risks that you're running, and then in that satisfy what you need to do under the each of the underlying regulations. It's almost, by the way, I'm left-handed, so whatever subject we raise, I quite often come to a similar answer to other panellists, but it will always be a different way round with a different explanation.
Yes, absolutely, and it's precisely because. Thanks very much. Okay, before I leave, any comments from the floor or from the panel before I leave that topic? No? Enrico, I did love your thing about, in your experience, you seem to have come across two types of people. Do you remember saying that? Do you remember this? Eli Warrock, you know, good, the bad and the ugly? There's two types of people in the world, my friend. those with a rope around their neck and those that whose job it is to do the cutting. And I was reminded of that because he was talking about the regulator and the regulated, you see. So, anyway, right, that's, like I said, that's enough movie quotes. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Now, I talked about origination because I thought, actually, this is very, both of you, a couple of you said, how do we make, so if you, I mean, both Enrique and Mr. Edwards talked about getting ALCO to ensure the balance sheet is in shape and stable and all that, and how does it ensure that? So I took that to mean an operating model issue. You know, is ALCO set up to be able to be effective? But actually, I wonder if it was the start of the process. So is it an origination issue? How can ALCO ensure, or should it? I think it should, but how can ALCO ensure that at the origination phase, so when we are lending money or taking in deposits, at that point, the form of those assets and liabilities, you know, their tenor, their rates, the price, you know, your margin, etc., the type of counterparty risk you take on, all that sort of stuff. At that point, should ALCO be doing something a bit more proactive to ensure the balance sheet is stable? So I thought at first, is it an operating model issue? So I've got a balance sheet, how can I ensure it's robustly controlled? But is it more of a proactive one? And I wonder if I can ask either of you to start on this, Chris and Enrique. You know, how should ALCO, how would it go about? Because we want to supply answers as well as problems here. How would it ensure the balance sheet is the way we want if it's not getting involved at the origination phase?
Yeah, I'm sort of pleased with the introduction of the net stable funding ratio because, I think it makes people take, again, a more conservative approach. So, smaller banks having longer-term liabilities is very difficult.
Yes.
But, again, and it's costly.
Yes.
But, it takes a lot of pressure off concentration in the shorter end. It gives you less profits.
But how does the smaller bank address that problem? Or indeed the larger bank? I mean, we can't all just go and issue 10-year paper. So how do we address it?
No, I mean, we actively borrow in the retail market. So we issue fixed bonds.
Okay. Term long.
We're typically people, in a lot of the challenger banks, and I know there are a few of them here tonight. You'll see them very active in the 1 year. I have a product out to 7 years.
In the retail space. Okay, that's very interesting.
And I think what's interesting, without giving away secrets, that a lot of people, when we sense interest rates are going to change, we're going to have a little go at the longer space. But the longer retail space is nowhere near the liquidity as you have in, say, the 1 or 2 year space. So, my view, to be proactive, there's a cost to pay. At some stage, we're at the lowest interest rate cycle known to man, unless you think we're going to have negative rates for a long period. Putting on some longer assets now, you might have to pay for them for a little bit longer, but it's a very conservative, in my view, sensible policy. So we're in a space where we tend to actually borrow a bit longer, and in some of our activities, because it's around trade, lend shorter, which is a very, very different model. But we're involved in, obviously, emerging markets where yields are a lot better. But I do think people should really take on net stable funding ratio, take it seriously, and put an add on them as well.
I mean, that's really interesting to hear that. I mean, like I said, we have diversity of views and experiences here on the panel, which is great. I mean, a bank that's borrowing for longer than it's lending is an unusual beast indeed. I'm going to come back to that in a second, actually, from an op model perspective. But I take into account it's a business model issue. That you're the treasurer, so one might expect you to say, let's take NSFR seriously and have lots of long-term funding on. One would expect it. How does the ALCO process, the treasurer, ensure that's actually done at the business line end? Before I do, though, just Enrique, did you have anything on that proactive side or origination side, or an opinion on the operating model?
Well, I just think the way part of the regulation at least is going in the industry is on setting some sort of constraints at the balance sheet level, and then setting some pricing constraints as well.
Who's setting that? ALCO?
Well, depends on the bank you're talking about. But generally, I mean, sometimes you have CBA desks, you have a front office or the first line doing the pricing. And I think what is important is that there is obviously first, the second line of defense, an independent risk function that justifies the way the first line is behaving.
That's the second line of defense.
Second line of defense. But also the fact that at alcohol, it has to be a holistic approach and not just thinking of, well, this is the risk and this is the pricing, but also discussions and challenge about the risk of the new product, for example. So when you introduce a new product, you have to think about conduct risk, how this with liquidity risk, ALM risk, capital, and credit, and so on and so forth. And I mean, having been in treasury function in the past in the bank and part of the ALCO, we did implement that process and it worked well. I mean, so sometimes it's just, I mean, obviously in a smaller bank, sometimes it's easier to implement that in a bigger bank where there's too much bureaucracy and too many sort of functions doing different things. But I think that's my
opinion. I mean, that's right. Let's take that last point as well. You know, in theory, it's easier to do that at a smaller bank. Let's say I get to the large multinational, you know, multi-entity. I still have this risk. What's the operating model that will implement this kind of better control in the way we've just heard described here at a larger bank? What are the pitfalls? I mean, it's easy to just say, oh, well, it's a political issue and there's a lot of bureaucracy. Can that be addressed? Can we fix that in some way? Looking at the two big bank people.
So I think there's certainly a chance that perhaps one of the differences you find between a small bank and a large bank, I think in a small bank, you've got a fighting chance that your treasury ALM function is very close to the new product development. In a large bank, you may well find that they're very far apart. So therefore, your treasury asset liability management function has got to find a way of being basically have relationships with all of the areas developing new products and bringing them to market. And if they have, most business areas will, I don't know, have a new product committee or some kind of approval process, and it's incumbent upon ALM, Treasury, to make sure they are involved in that chain. And if you look at, should we say, from a retail perspective, what are some of the horrors that we've all allowed to happen around us? I don't know, base rate minus 1% for life mortgage. I don't know, things like that.
Even so at the time, you thought that was pretty cool.
Well, I'm not necessarily saying I thought it was good at the time, but what?
No, clearly, knowing you, I'm pretty sure you would have said something. You know, I bet a week's pay at the time. You said, "Are we sure we want to do this, guys?" You know.
Well, but that challenge and you know whatever. If we look at all the horrors and look at what was approved, what went wrong, and how do we stop it? At least you get the chance to put your two penny worth in at the point of that product is released.
So the operating model is such that it's got to allow the Treasury stroke ALM stroke risk function to have that power, and power is the wrong word, influence.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because I've even seen it at small banks lacking that. So that's the challenge. Mm-hmm. So I think we need I personally like to see the character, the personality staying out of it. It doesn't matter who, what sort of person is the treasurer or the risk person or the head of ALM, the functions of the office should ensure that level of influence. Mm-hmm. That's the challenge for the banks. Okay. Did you have a comment, PG?
I suppose two points. One is in relation to the operating model for a smaller bank. I think, you know, obviously ALCO has certain powers, but that's within the remit of the board risk appetite. So, you know, the board will set the risk appetite with input from ALCO and Treasury and, you know, various professionals. Then you have a series of maybe frameworks and triggers that operate for ALCO, which is fine. And so in a smaller bank, I think it's easier with that end-to-end process. You're more involved in the product pricing decisions. You run into people in the corridor. It's a different style of management. So I think that's the smaller bank model. In a bigger bank, I think very often you have regional hubs, which go some way towards this because you have a certain amount of grouping of different, you know, types of businesses. But I think you are back to the kind of new product sign-off and, you know, the kind of processes internally and the communication channels for saying, well, yes, these are the kind of products we want to sell, we're going to sell. What does that mean for the bank's balance sheet? And how is that going to be, how is the risk on that going to be managed and controlled? So you're into a kind of probably a more funneled type approach in a bigger bank, I think. And in a smaller bank, theoretically, you should be able to have a much more integrated approach to that kind of management.
Yeah, absolutely right. I liked your comment about you run into that chap in the corridor and you could have a chat about it. That's actually really, that's very important. Another close personal friend of mine, Colin Johnson, Santander, can't be with us tonight. I once was having a conversation with him about strategic ALM and proactive ALM. And how do we ensure that? And he said, the best way to do it is what we did at West Brom Building Society. We had the head of lending sat next to the head of deposit taking. And I thought, brilliant, that would solve it. You know, in a larger bank, they'll be in different buildings, they'll be in different towns, you know. So that communication thing is actually as important as the op model itself, the fact that they can run into the corridor and talk to them, whereas in a larger bank, it could be in another town, as I say, in my personal experience, I've seen that. So, okay, thank you. We have a question online, actually, in case you're wondering who's put their hand up. It's come here from online. If one is borrowing for, so this must be for you, Mr. Edwards. If one is borrowing for longer tenors than one is lending, what kind of markets do you end up lending to you? Do you move to other markets other than the ones you're getting your funding from? That's a good observation.
I'll take the second bit first. Yes, we definitely have to move to different markets we're taking our funding from, otherwise we wouldn't make any money. But we're typically involved, in the emerging market space, and we're our bank moves around trade, commodity trade finance, and short-term finance on shipping commodities is quite lucrative. So, while we have issues with swapping sterling, which we raise over here, into dollars, which we do most of our sort of trade business in, there are risks, but we think we understand that space, and it's very niche, and we get paid for it. So
that's a fair point. Absolutely. I mean, I did think, evidently it's going to have to be switching across, if not necessarily markets, certainly sectors.
Yeah, I mean,
because otherwise, you in a positive yield curve, you would be having a negative NII. Yeah, okay, but I think that answers the question reasonably well.
I mean, I kind of see.
I see his point. Yes.
Banks in the UK taking huge amounts of risk at the moment for very, very small return, and I think people have forgotten how to price risk. So I think some of the bigger banks, their models are really suffering. And
okay, thank you. Let's name some names here. No, but just another comment of yours, PGR. You talked about the board risk appetite driving the ALCO managing the balance sheet. But I've got a question back on that. I've got a challenge back on that. What if the board's statement is airy fairy? It's qualitative. Yeah, is that going to be sufficient? Do we need hard quantitative limits for all across the board, for capital, liquidity, the lot, interest rate risk, to do that? Because some risk appetite statements are more qualitative.
I agree. I mean, my own belief is you need some level of quantification, but with kind of tiering or, the red and the green, whatever you want to call it. But you do need some kind of level of quantification coming from the board, because otherwise, where is the edict to ALCO effectively? If ALCO wants to do certain things, yes, you're completely within the appetite, or actually you're starting to get very close to, maybe busting through some kind of either limit or sentiment. And, where is the driver for ALCO then to come back and say, well, actually, we're doing a rewrite of our risk appetite. It's not material, but actually we want to, make sure the board is fully informed of this. So you need that loop back process, and I don't see how you can do that without some level of quantification.
Absolutely.
At the outset,
yeah.
But without being overly prescriptive.
Yes, absolutely understood. Yes, and that's the challenge there. Okay, righto. Okay, excellent. Good, great, thank you. So, time is pressing. Now, let's move on to another topic, if I may, which I'm sure the panel are going to love, which is qualitative. It has a touch of airy-fairiness about it, actually. Have we heard that larger banks especially are recruiting across the board hundreds, thousands of people, depending on the size, thousands of people to within their compliance functions to ensure that conduct risk is not something that they fall over on. So my question for the panel, so here again I want to hear from all of them, is conduct risk, operational risk, what's the best practice benchmark? By the way, someone said to me, what does best practice mean? I said, well, take 10 people in the market, the one who's doing the best job is best practice. what else the answer is there? What is the best practice? Are we getting too tick box? If I recruit, and there are some, you'd have read this in the press, some of the larger banks, high street names, a very large US institution, hiring thousands, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 staff, group wide, worldwide, for their compliance function, to ensure, they have sufficient comfort on that op risk, the conduct risk area. Is this the right approach? How would you, again, with your hypothetical bank, go about ensuring that conduct and the culture to ensure compliance and conduct risk exposure was the right one, other than just hiring thousands of compliance staff to police it? Let's see, who wants to get...
I was always willing to volunteer.
Mr. Westcott, off you go.
To me, this really starts with the cultural side. I think it's easy as you look back to see where cultures haven't been quite right. But I think if every banker or anyone involved in any of these functions was to ask themselves the question, would I be happy to be the other side of what I've just sold? And if the answer is always yes, I think move on. Now, I was thinking just on the way here about almost the worst example I could find, and I think in the culture of where I was, and we won't go into that, one day I came across a 10-year personal loan, and the APR was reasonable, somewhere between 5 and 10%, that looks fine, and I happened to be doing some of the, should we say, the hedging behind. And the size of the hedge, it was a £10,000 loan for 10 years. And with, the amount paid back at the end of the period without PPI was a total of $25,000. And with PPI was $42,000. Now, that struck me at the time. There's something very fishy about this. What are my chances of, should we say, at that time, the economy's booming, what are my chances over the next 10 years of finding myself, I can claim on this? And, I might have persuaded myself it was 10%. But there's no way on this planet was it almost a 50-50 bet. And therefore, I think, most of the time, we know. The rules are coming in really to kind of hold us to the fire and make sure we do what's right. But I completely agree with you that it's actually totally the wrong response to get 10,000 people in and say, right, tick back the rule. Because the fact is, if you've got the right culture, you will be doing 98% of the rule anyway. And then you have five people instead of 5,000 or whatever to just come in and check it at the edges.
Excellent. I didn't know what you were going to say, but I love your answer. Fantastic. Who's next on this one?
Let's see. I'm, my phrase kind of thinking about this for tonight was really, if you can put yourself in the shoes of the customer, which goes back to kind of Chris's point of, if you were happy to be on the other side of that transaction. So I think a lot of it is around product suitability for the customer. I think the regulators kind of have worked on getting at this around, treating your customer fairly, all that kind of stuff. But I think, culture is kind of an intangible thing, but I suppose with all of this, you know, the customer journey, people know when they've had a good experience and they know when they haven't had a good experience. And what you're seeking to do is achieve that intangible of customers coming away, feeling they've had a good experience, but that the bank has provided the service and, kind of no fallout from that other than, positive customer feedback.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
For my sins, part of the thing I do on the BTRM is talk about conduct risk. And I came from an era from the London Stock Exchange where my word was my bond. And people conducted business, and people thought about continuing doing business. relationships lasted a long time. You know, people didn't rip off their customer. In a lot of cases, there were fixed commissions. Everyone said, oh, it's so bad. But, you know, I wonder whether perhaps we need to go back to something like that so people know where they stand. But I think the saddest thing is, yeah, it's come from the top, the culture, and it's been greed, driven by greed and performance, and people will do anything. And yeah, I've seen youngsters, and you know, I give this as a great example that I used to run trading teams many years ago, and brightest traders you can believe, and come out with fantastic degrees. And they turn up and they hit the trading floor. And these guys have been really hardworking, they're incredibly intelligent, and they've never failed at anything. So suddenly, they actually start trading in a market where, you know, they think they understand where the risk is, blah, blah, blah. And of course, the unexpected happens. For the first time in their life, they're failing. Well, you know, what do they do? And I think another big, big issue was that after Big Bang, a hell of a lot of what I used to call grey heads that used to be around in the city disappeared. And everyone said it's a young man's game and everything else. So there was nobody to guide them anymore. Nobody who had experience. Yeah, yeah. How many people have sat on the floor when rates have gone from 10 to 12 to 15 and back to 12?
What a great day that was. Yeah. I was at Hawkeye Securities. I've never heard this floor scream so loud in pleasure at the money they were making. Sorry.
we traded through that. You know. So I kind of feel that a lot of people are very sceptical and say it's going to take a long time to shift the culture. But I think Mr. Wheatley has turned around and mentioned that these very large fines are starting to have a very quick effect. And it's amazing how quickly people will react to when it's costing the banks a lot of money. So it's being driven now from the top. It's probably going to take a little bit longer.
Yes.
But I personally think it will change quicker than people anticipate.
I don't know. I'm not going to comment. That's a
especially if you have an unlimited fine or go to jail for 7 years under the new senior manager.
That's true. But how long has that been around?
You as a CEO, you're signing up to that.
Oh, of course, yes. Well, listen, everyone buy a second-hand car off me. Listen, that's a very good point. I'm going to come to that in a second. We just had a question there.
Well, it is a sort of question. I guess. Bear
one second. Do we want to? No, okay, go ahead, sir.
I mean, I think the first point is, I think the new senior managers regime, which is coming in under British law in next year, all being as expected, I think will have some impact, because I think the accountability of the board and the reduced capacity to say you were ignorant of the circumstances will have an effect, and I think it's already having an effect. But I still do have some concerns. I think, back to Chris's point, and it feels here a little bit like a rhetorical question, are we actually hiring lots of compliance officers to tick boxes that we're changing things, or is there genuine cultural change going on? And I think from the reaction here of some people shaking their heads and some nodding, leaves a big question mark there at the moment, doesn't it, as to whether it is just recruitment of large amounts of people to put lots of rules into place,
which is a sort of strange
way of going about it.
Okay, so the question I thought I'd have to thank you for that. So the question on the floor was, you know, it's we are moving on to, in the UK certainly, the senior persons regime, where individuals will be personally accountable. They one couldn't claim ignorance. You know, if it happens under your watch, there's a potential jail or fine as a result, and also the idea of hiring people to tick boxes, you know, is all well and good, but the culture should be changing sooner rather than later, you know, as a result of unlimited fines. That's an opinion. I would like to think so. Okay, so I think I've summarised your point. Yeah, absolutely. I think I agree with all the comments on the panel. Enrique, do you have anything to add to that? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think first of all, we will need to define what conduct risk is, which is quite broad. It covers treating customers fairly, integrity, remuneration, it's everything really, right? but I mean, the other on the compliance side, I think that's quite interesting, the senior manager's regime and influence functions and so on. But accountability is key, obviously. But the fact is that we can't deny that the role of compliance is changing. because traditional compliance has have a sort of legal function, regulatory function, and so on and so forth. And now the challenge is, compliance, we all are responsible for compliance in the financial system, right?
True.
So then what's the new role of compliance if we all compliance?
Very right? True.
And then when you think about what compliance is now, it covers countries, also prudential. We just mentioned we have new product introduction, we have to do pricing, we have to assess the risk. And that covers conduct risk as well. So you can't be just a conduct risk person without knowing our prudential, and you can't be prudential without knowing conduct. So I think that calls for a more integrative approach, new data analytics, and it's putting conduct risk as well on the spotlight, because it's going to be a new risk managed in the way traditionally risk has been managed. You want to have risk appetite, metrics, metrics at ACO levels and other risk committee levels and compliance level. And then there's also the question of if you have first line and second line, and traditional compliance has done both first line and second line roles. So you think about it, compliance did an independence assurance control, but also provide advice to the first line, to the front office. And that has to change if you want to create a proper structure, independence, and move to the new structure.
And what should it change structure. To? What should it change to?
It will change to a three lines of defense, where you have an independence risk function. You can call it compliance in some organization, other organization will call it risk, others will call it ExCo risk board committee level. It's not about how you call it, but how you identify your risk.
And what's the third line?
Third line will be internal audit.
Okay, as always. Okay, no, I just want to make sure I understood that. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, thank you. It's pretty unarguable what I've just heard from all four of them, right? And indeed from the floor. So, great, we're all understood. I just wonder if that risks, so I'm playing devil's advocate here, I wonder if that risks going into motherhood and apple pie territory. We all know that have the right person, get the right culture, comes from the top, do all the right things. They've got an added incentive because there's a senior person's regime, so you can go to jail, etc., etc. Has anyone been covering this LIBOR rigging trial in the papers recently? There's a gentleman currently in court being accused, the first individual being accused of rigging LIBOR. I don't know if you're reading the reports of it. Without commenting on that case, and apparently he'd taken a huge bonus, an unbelievable one, for working in a bank. I mean, this chap wasn't Richard Branson, or he didn't set up Kentucky Fried Chicken or something. He worked in a bank, okay? And the last bonus was 2.2 million or something. I mean, it's getting into silly money. Now, contrast some of the comments coming. Here's the question for the panel. If you're familiar with the case, I'm sure you all are. Some of the comments coming attributed to this gentleman, okay? Which obviously reflect his way of doing things, the culture, allegedly, the prosecution alleges, got to cover myself here, the culture in which he worked, the fact that he wasn't the only person there, other people knew what he was doing. I mean, today's Times said the current senior guy at Deutsche, ex-head of the desk at UBS, was involved in the meeting and all that. You're trying to tell me that person is the only one. Is that culture being kicked out? Or how many people are still around us here in EC2 reflecting that same sort of culture, such that they don't really care if the person on the other side is losing out on some of these examples we've just heard? You know, the question is, do we need to get the right type of individual in all these desks to make this culture work? Because we can all say the right things, you know, but if we have people such as this individual, allegedly, working in these banks, then the culture's going to go nowhere, right? Yeah, I just wondered if anyone had an observation on that, because the values being attributed to this gentleman and the team in which he worked aren't what everyone around here is saying, are they? That was all. I just wondered if anyone had an observation on that.
Personally, I think the incentivization process has a huge amount to answer for. As a bank, as an industry, we did not get it right. I remember going right, and I know this is an example on LIBOR, but I remember going right back to the beginning. I wasn't in the Treasury function, so maybe, I don't know, 20 years ago, and suddenly I'm merrily jogging along, doing my work, getting paid, and then suddenly someone comes up to me and says, "Well done, Chris. Here's 10%. I'm going, "Why?" And they say, oh, it's bonus, performance bonus. Oh, okay. When it first came in, it very much struck me, you know, I haven't done anything differently.
You could have given it back.
Well, I could have done. But I didn't, because like everybody else.
Absolutely.
And I think from that moment on, everybody suddenly, you know, it's pretty tough. Okay, you're giving me 10, so now what do I have to do to get 20 or 30 or 50?
Exactly right.
And then suddenly we move away from what's the right thing for the business, and we move into how do I get 20, 30, 40, 50? And I've heard some ridiculous examples, and some of them actually as part of this forum, and where, you know, treasurers in particular positions can set up books that can't fail to make money.
Absolutely.
But they're on all the wrong assumptions. So, I don't know, I think the example was I fund it at LIBOR flat.
Yes,
and it's a treasury bill or whatever. A gilt or something.
Just to be clear to everyone listening, that's not an observation we've had on the BTRM forum. So former and current students have an interactive forum session, and one of them made an observation anecdote from a bank that he worked at previously where the treasurer managed FTP, funds transfer pricing, but also ran a portfolio that was just within Treasury and was able to fund it at unrealistic funding rates because they were also selling FTP. Exactly the point I think you're making, you know, that you get individuals who are doing that, and this is what we need to address. The point on incentivization, again, I love that anecdote. You know, you hadn't done anything differently, or that you would not, but suddenly here you go, here's an extra chunk of cash. Definitely something that still needs to be addressed, but not in that kind of shrieking, wailing and gnashing of teeth way that politicians do it. I think the industry itself could see what should we do to make this more fit for purpose rather than just getting, you know, EC commissioners to put caps and things like that. You know, that just gets knee-jerk reactions. Okay, look, I see what I could listen to this all night. But given that we're into the last quarter, do we have any questions on the floor or on the camera for the panel on any of these topics? No? Didn't tickle your fancy. Okay, well that's just as well because I have one more topic. Like I said, I can talk all evening. How are banks to address? We talked about strategic ALM, the required op model to ensure a proactive approach. So we had that conversation. I just wonder if there's another incentive given that banks face pressures. It's a live issue for whether you're in a large or a small bank. They face pressures on all fronts. There is competition still on the high street. There is the cost of regulation. There are umpteen regulatory processes and requirements going through, whether it's interest rate risk in the banking book, intraday liquidity reporting, this, that, and the other, capital, buffers on top of buffers. We have buffers coming out of our ears. Has anyone ever asked themselves, why do we need all these buffers? Let's just make 20%, leave it at that. We don't need all these buffers. But anyway, we have all these issues pressuring banks and companies as well. Are we aware also that, of course, that there is non-bank competition as well? You know, we will be, of course, a rhetorical question. How do we think banks should up their game to address this threat? Because we have, there's a quote attributed to Jamie Dimon, but I don't know if he actually said it. He said, when Google starts becoming a bank, we'll all be in trouble. I mean, I'm not entirely sure that's actually something I'd agree with, but I see his point. How should banks go about if they're already struggling to get data issues, get on top of data issues, get on top of getting their pricing risk addressed, you know, making sure that each individual entity is compliant with leverage ratio and not just the group, all these other issues that we've currently identified, understanding the balance sheet, understanding the risk, that was Enrique's point, genuinely understanding it. On top of all that, how should we face the competition from non-bank financials, from fintech, from people who understand their customers and their customer data analytics much better than we do? Okay, you know, because they do digital, their digital connectivity is so much better than ours. How should we address that? What should banks do to address that? Because otherwise they'll be cherry-picking all the best lucrative bits of business, leaving us just with current accounts and not much else. Enrique, what do you think we should be doing to up our game on that front?
Well, I think there's a few things that banks can do about, I mean, the question is whether they will really work or not. I think obviously this bigger focus on particular areas, and then niche banks come over and they have a specialism. Chris mentioned that as well, and I think there's probably more and more sort of trend on that route of going and moving more to specialized lending, specialized liabilities or funding side as well. Also, we have to think about the interaction again between conduct risk and prudential risk. I mean, if you come new to the market, which is your customer journey, when you deal with the customer, and banks can't, big banks can't do that cross-selling anymore without thinking about the implications. And you're giving a mortgage, negative rate. I mean, what's the cross-selling you can do? And so it touches a lot on conduct risk. I mean, I think there's the cost base, which is very important at the moment, on the bottom line. And there's different strategies, consolidation. I mean, being from Spain, I know that most Spanish banks actually currently are trying to outsource all their IT technology platforms. I think that this customer acquisition and big data, I think that's a new trend, and I think it's going to be very important. Customer analytics, we are used to go to the branch and or any other shop, and we want the company to know where we want already before we get in through the door. And to be honest, we all know that, I mean, bank branches are not the most appealing place to go. Right? And you can see some entities actually changing the outlay in the bank branches, trying to make most of it being in some iPads and some computers, making a nice place to stay into be, which again touches a lot on conduct risk. Sorry for the focus there. And obviously analytics, and then I think coming to the risk identification, there are new risks coming out from this. I mean, if we go more online, more technological, we have cyber risk is one of the key areas now of focus as well, because I think some banks didn't have any online customers 5 years ago. They do have most of the customers going online and checking the phones online. I mean, I myself don't go to a bank branch unless I need to do. And it's not the best way to go through, because I don't enjoy going to a bank branch. If I go there, it's to complain. Right.
Okay. Who do you bank with? So no, don't tell us.
Right. I think those are a few strategies that they can use.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much. Anyone else on that? No?
Okay. Yeah, I've got so from the technological side, I think banks have absolutely no choice but to totally embrace and be at the front of change. Because if you look, at examples, recent examples, any big company that doesn't embrace the change that's happening doesn't last very long. For example, HMV and their videos and they're forgetting to set up an offline, an online route, they didn't last in physical location only. Going back to IBM, who said the PC would never take off, and then almost went out of business as a result. So the banks, and I think certainly in some of this fintech area, where banks are actually grouping together because they realise that it's not necessarily their skill, yeah. And they're best almost protecting themselves against the rest of the world by grouping together, and through grouping together, trying to be at the forefront of the change process. In terms of one element, this costs a huge amount of money. So where on earth in the current environment are banks going to find the huge amount of money to invest in being at the forefront of development? And we come back to physical locations and branches. It's a bit like the post office and letters. Banks are having to get rid of branches very quickly because the physical location costs too much. I think that there's some, underdeveloped thinking in that area, because all that I've seen in the last 10 years is, as you say, Enrique, it's the same old branch with a lick of paint and maybe an iPad. No one's really done anything radical. And we talked about, let's have coffee shops in there. That hasn't worked. They're all the same, or banks in supermarkets. None of it has happened. So I can't help thinking banks have to do something with their physical locations. If they switch them off completely, they'll switch off half of the people who bank with them who still want them to have physical locations. So they've got to have them, but they've got to do something different. And the question that I was thinking of is, what is that? What's going to be different that will work? It could be anything. I wondered if we should partnership with the post office, because we've both got the same problem. So have half the branch is a post office and the other half is a bank.
That's not a bad idea.
but they're definitely, you know, we've probably got, I know in the UK, 10,000 branches still, or 5 to 10,000.
Yeah,
and the number, yeah. Those 5 to 10,000 need to think pretty quickly, because the cost of maintaining them with half the footfall isn't going to work. Sorry, I'll shut up.
No, I'm listening. I was recording. You know, it's just a comment for PG to speak up a bit. Okay, there's all very good observations. Did you have a comment on this one?
Just to say the whole point.
Just imagine I'm at the end of the room and you got to shout.
The whole point about mobile banking and, you know, people being able to bank on the weekend regardless of where they are. You know, like you say, there's more pressure on banks, but it's kind of meet the challenge or kind of, you know, fail to succeed, really.
I mean, it costs a lot of money, and as Chris said, you know, it's where you're going to get that. It's a big, I mean, I was going to say, ideally, you would try and get an approach to IT, your technology, the algorithmic approach that enables you to understand your customer in the way that, say, Amazon and Google and people like that do, which takes a lot of time and money and resources. But that's a solution, but it's not a short-term one. I just wanted to comment on branches, because you're right, apart from a lick of paint, it's not really much done with them, but I wonder if they just need some more imagination there. The city branch of, so I'm a NatWest customer. You know, I've been since my mum opened my account for me when I was at school. It was 30 years ago, 31 years ago now. The city branch of NatWest, you know, I have been hanging out there, but then you could think, yeah, well, that's because you've been unemployed for a year, Moorad. But no, seriously, it's got free Wi-Fi, it's got really comfy sofas, there's lots of room in there, it's a really nice ambiance, they have got free tea and coffee. I'm not a tea and coffee drinker, but I can see the point. You know, and I have, you know, I've spent time in there, you know, I've done Skype calls with my daughter to say goodnight to her when it's past their bedtime and I'm still in town. You know, I like the ambience in there. You know, it's very user friendly. If you'd want to do banking, they've got the ATMs on one side, they've got the counter on the other. The staff are not, they don't come and say, can I help you? They just wait. If you need help, they're there. If not, they'll leave you to it. I did say to them, you should put Sky TV up on that big TV rather than just your adverts. And they said, we'll take that under advisory. It's a good place. Now, and I must admit, the city branch of NatWest is a big bank. There's a lot of room in there. Very few branches of any institution have, you know, I think that was like their head office for a while, you know, the actual institute, you know, before they were RBS. But my point is, you can turn it into a place where people don't mind going. Enrique only goes in there to complain, he doesn't want to bother with the branch, but not every, that's because maybe a lot of them are as unwelcoming, and I don't deny that as that. But you can do things with branches, okay? But anyway, sadly for me, my time at that will be, as Mr. Edwards has pointed out, I've got a job now, so my time there will be curtailed, but that's a shame because I did enjoy going in there. Right, okay, we're almost out of time. So on the basis that, I would like to invite to see the panel if they had any closing remarks, if anyone has any closing remarks, while they ponder that. Do we have any questions from the floor at all or on the screen? I see one here. Nothing on the floor, but, oh gosh, that's a long one. Okay, just to say that, Mr. Eugene, I will come back to you, sir, offline, because we're almost out of time. Forgive me for not seeing your comment earlier. No questions.
Just a quick one on the subject of fintech and that side of things. What do the panel think about peer-to-peer lending? Because I've got a bit of a view in that it's all great while it's new, but it's essentially, you know, sort of taking the banks out of the scene and covering the risk management from a saver's point of view, which frankly savers aren't in any position to understand, especially the super cycles you get in, you know, boom and bust and long term. But just be interested to hear what the view is of that and the threat and the...
Thank you, Martin. So the question in the room was, what do the panel think of peer-to-peer lending? Depending on your jurisdiction, for those of you not in the room, you know, it's obviously something that's, it's not new. It's 3 or 4 years old. You know, been, there have some big portfolios now in the US and in Western Europe, peer-to-peer. Does anyone have any opinion on peer-to-peer?
I think we need to go through a complete business cycle. So where I have a concern, I mean, if we look back at anything that has a single source of funding doesn't normally get through a whole business cycle. So if we go back to, I don't know, LIBOR-related mortgages and firms that just set up, borrowed at LIBOR, pumped out the mortgage, you know, there are certain points in the cycle where that doesn't work or they're uncompetitive. And likewise with peer-to-peer, the because it's a single source of funding at the moment, I worry about when there's a downturn and potential liquidity challenges, and then people will get stuck in a position where, although it's advertised that you can take your money out at a 1% cost or something, the fact is you won't be able to, and when that happens, there'll be some kind of knock-on consequence. It's a good idea, so I don't think it will kill it completely, but it might take a knock.
Personally, for what it's worth, I completely agree with that. I think, you know, the business media love peer-to-peer. You know, there was an article I read in the British Airways Business Journal just recently saying peer-to-peer was going to, you know, get rid of, you know, it's going to kill banks. You know, they're going to lose all the business peer-to-peer. Yes, right. When they introduce a current account, yes, I think they might. But that's a fair point. You know, I think we need to observe it over a cycle and need to observe how customers, i.e. lenders into that experience, what their experience is when we have some bigger defaults. Okay, pretty much out of time. So it's really incumbent on me just to thank our hosts again, Ivan Robertson, yourselves for coming, those on the camera, and thank the panel indeed. I hope you, as I did, got some value out of those. I enjoyed listening to that, and some very, very good anecdotes and personal observations. So thank you to Patricia Geraghty, TSB, Chris Westcott, Faculty BTRM, Enrique Benito, Deloitte's, and Chris Edwards, FBN. Thanks very much indeed. Thank you, and we will see you at the next Faculty Forum, which is actually in 2016. Before that, we have the BTRM Conference. That's right, we're going up market. No more just an hour and a quarter in the evenings. You get 2 days of all this kind of chat. The BTRM October Bank Risk Management Conference. So details on the LinkedIn group and indeed on the forum. Thanks very much. Have a good evening. Thanks, chaps. Always a pleasure. Have a good evening.